سبيل الدموع سبيل مريح تنا أدى يا صاحي كي تستمع.
الله وسلم على من أرسل إلى الناس بشيرا ونذيرا. وبعد، يقول المولى جل جلاله: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وآمنوا برسوله يؤتكم كفلين من رحمته ويجعل لكم نورا تمشون به ويغفر لكم والله غفور رحيم. أيها الإخوة الكرام, the Prophet Musa عليه السلام, also known as Moses in English, is the most mentioned prophet in the entire Quran. And among the many reasons why is that he had one of the most remarkable lives that ever humankind has witnessed. And not just him as a prophet, not even just him as an adult, but him as a baby. Yes, we can extract remarkable lessons, gems and pearls from even his life as a newborn, even his life as a toddler. And let me share with you just some of those gems found in the opening passages of Surah Al-Qasas. We know that Pharaoh was massacring the infant boys of Banu Israel. So he sent out his soldiers, who were like the ancient form of the CIA, FBI, and ASIO, to go and raid the houses of the Muslims. So of course they were kicking down houses. Any child they would find from Banu Israel, they would slaughter them on the spot. You know, shoot now, ask questions later. And so of course the mother of Musa alayhi salam, she was witnessing this scene. You can imagine she was probably, you know, peering up from her window, the curtains, sliding it, and seeing that they were kicking down these houses. And she was worried because she had a baby boy. And she was even more worried because this baby boy was crying, you know, something that babies do best. So she didn't know what to do. You know, if they hear a baby boy crying, what's going to happen? They're going to enter and they're going to kill him, maybe even kill her. So she's panicking. So she's trying to lull him to sleep. Nothing's working. You know, trying to burp him, nothing's working. Check his diaper, maybe that's why he's crying. No, nothing's wrong. So what's the issue? Now, of course, he needed to breastfeed. Now you say, okay, no brainer, how come she didn't know that? When a person's panicking, even the simplest of tasks become difficult. So Allah Azza wa Jal intervened. Allah said, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمِّ مُوسَىٰ أَنْ أَرْضِعِي. We inspired the mother of Musa, give him milk. Allah Azza wa Jal intervened here. You know why? Because she was one who would remember Allah Azza wa Jal when times were easy, so Allah Azza wa Jal helped her and remembered her when times were hard. That's the first lesson. You know, some people, they only pray when they're in trouble. If you only pray when you're in trouble, you're definitely in trouble. So Allah intervened, give him milk. She gave him milk. You know, when a baby's drinking, what do you hear? Nothing. All you hear is, he's drinking. So of course the soldiers walk straight past the house. They didn't hear a sound. And they don't enter. Now, is a baby going to remain silent forever? Of course not. So Allah Azza wa Jal added, فَإِذَا خِفْتِ عَلَيْهِ. So when you feel for him again, when he starts crying and these soldiers come back, فَأَلْقِهِ فِي الْيَمْ. Put him in the river. Allahu Akbar. Something that's really easy, I'm sure. Of course not. How difficult is it for not just a parent, a mother, to put her child in the river? You know, they say the greatest bond is the bond between mother and child. Nothing comes between that bond. Not even a loving husband. And if you're married, you will testify to this fact. You know, you're at the opposite side of the house, you're with your wife, you're giving her attention, love and care, you know, and your newborn just makes the slightest sound. Yay, my baby! She runs all the way to the opposite side of the house. Yani, your child is probably holding the fork the wrong way. You know, your wife, she breaks the record for high jump. Look, give me that fork. Yani, we know that among the strongest bonds ever is the bond between mother and child. Yes, but there's something that comes in between that bond. Something greater, and that is the bond between the master and his slave. Between Allah and the abd. And proof is that when Allah told her to do this, to put her child in what seemed certain death into a river, she did it. Allahu Akbar. Imagine the strength of the mother of Musa to do that. Very difficult indeed. And we can take lessons from the chapters of the mother of Musa. And we're not shy to say this. We can learn from women, yes. And among them, the mother of Musa alayhi salam. And we said that's something very difficult. You know, because three things that don't mix are mothers, babies, and water. True, and if you're married once again, you'll realize this fact. Mothers, babies, and water don't mix. You know, when we had a newborn girl, and I had to bath her for the first time, You know, my wife is like, Allah Ta'ala, let me do it. I go, no, it's all right, you know, I can take care of this. She goes, no, no, please, I fear the baby's going to drown. I go, what are you talking about? Look how strong I am compared to this child. It's fine. She goes, okay, in that case, let me fill the bathtub up. She filled the bathtub that much. I go, Habibi, even the rubber ducky's not going to drown in that, let alone even, can't even swim, let alone drown. So it shows us how much, you know, women, mothers fear for their children when it comes, you know, to water. You know, I remember a story once. I was in Kmart and we were in the toy section and we walked past, you know, where they have those inflatable boats. I go, yalla, bismillah, let's grab one. You know, I put it under my arm. My wife's like, what are you doing? I go, what does it look like I'm doing? I'm buying this. She goes, I don't think so. I go, no, I think so. You know, let's go down to Chipping Norton Lake, have some fun. She goes, no, no, please put it back. I go, it's going to be all right. You know, the whole way there, she's complaining. You know, and we're not blaming our wives for this. This is something that Allah has put in them because of their care for their children. And we get there at the lake, you know, I'm pumping up this boat. You know, my wife's heart is pumping at the same time. She goes, okay, in that case, let me put some floaties, you know, on my son. She puts one on each arm. Wallah, if she could, she could have put one on each leg, each toe, kaman. Yani, and my son was like this, like an astronaut going into the water. Wallahi, I went in knee deep and my wife almost had a heart attack. Look, Allah Ta'ala, get him out of the water. It just shows us how much, you know, mothers fear for their children when it comes to water. You know, one brother asked me once, you know, how long did the, you know, what happened to the boat afterwards, you know, that inflatable boat? I go, it didn't last one day. And it shows you that my wife was right all along. But the point is that women, when it comes to their children and water, subhanAllah, something that they're terrified, and of course this is something which we don't blame them for, it's a natural instinct that they have. But she did it. She put him in the river, and we know, cutting a long story short, baby Musa ends up at the castle of Pharaoh. The very person she was trying to avoid. It looks bad, but we don't know what good can come after that. We're going to see what happens soon, inshallah. But it shows you, never doubt the divine decree of Allah. Sometimes, you know, a calamity strikes, it looks bad, but that's in our eyes, that's in our opinion. To Allah Azza wa Jal, it's totally different, because the misfortunes of a believer are fortunes in disguise. So fast forwarding these ayat in Surah Al-Qasas, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the heart of the mother of Musa. The heart of a mum or a parent who just lost their child. How would that heart be? Allah Azza wa Jal describes it with one word. وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَى فَارِغًا. Allah said the mother of Musa's heart, her heart became فارغ, empty. Emptied out of all emotions. Ibn Kathir mentions she would not think of anything or anyone but her child. She was empty. You know, when the heart is empty, everything is empty. You know, the eyes are stunned, mouth gaping open, you do that, no reaction, emotionally paralyzed. And if you've ever witnessed a parent who's lost their child, that's exactly how they are. Traumatized. Not just trauma, perhaps feeling guilty, remorseful, maybe it's my fault that the child passed away. She didn't know what happened to her kid. And now when you're in such a state, you could get the idea to do something that you're not supposed to maybe doubt Allah, say words that you're not supposed to. You get waswas from the shaitan. And Allah Azza wa Jal mentions this. In kadat latubidi bihi. She almost gave him up. She almost ran outside and said, where's my child? Where's my child? I put him in the river. And if she did that, she would have exposed herself. This word mu'min comes from iman. And what is iman? Is it just in the heart? We know. No. Iman starts in the heart, but it doesn't end in the heart. True faith is manifested, it's proven on the limbs. Showing us that she didn't just sit there feeling sorry for herself, she did something. She proved her iman on the limbs. What did she do? Allah tells us in the next ayah, وَقَالَتْ لِأُخْتِهِ قُصِّي. She told her daughter, go and follow him, find your little brother. In other words, she did something about it. Sometimes when a calamity strikes, a person is traumatized, they just sit there feeling sorry for themselves and they do nothing about it. Allah's telling us, no, do something. If you look at Maryam alayhi salam, the mother of Jesus, she was accused of indecency. She didn't just sit there and do nothing. We look at Imam Ahmad, he was imprisoned. He didn't sit there and do nothing. Imam Bukhari's mother was a widow. Likewise, she didn't just sit there and do nothing. None of them sat there feeling sorry for themselves. No, they acted, they did something to change a situation, and all of them and others, they changed our Islamic history. They altered the course of history, subhanAllah, when it came to our Islamic legacies. Showing us that when a trialing, you know, a traumatic experience, you know, or when you go through a traumatic experience, once again to put your iman in Allah Azza wa Jalla, but actually to do something, and that's what the mother of Musa alayhi salam did. So Musa's sister, she's looking out for him, and she doesn't know that Musa alayhi salam, her little baby brother, was taken into the castle of Pharaoh, and they actually accepted him. And it's one thing for Pharaoh not to kill this baby. That's one, that's miraculous enough. But Pharaoh doesn't just not kill him. He actually takes him in, and not even as a slave or a servant, he adopts him as his own child. What are the chances of that? Impossible odds, subhanAllah. But with Allah, nothing's impossible. So she doesn't know that her young baby brother is in the castle safe. And babies, especially newborns, they have to eat constantly, you know, every 2 hours. You know, kind of like, you know, pregnant women and bodybuilders always have to eat. So this baby needs to eat. So it's feeding time. So he's in the castle. They bring him some milk, you know, breast milk. Wouldn't accept. Another woman wouldn't accept. Cow's milk, wouldn't accept. Goat's milk, wouldn't accept. Wouldn't accept anything. You know, like some brothers, nah, bro, I only accept skim milk. Nah, cows, I only accept coconut milk. No. Musa alayhi salam wouldn't accept any milk. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَحَرَّمْنَا عَلَيْهِ الْمَرَاضِعَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. We made breastfeeding haram on him, forbidden on him. Meaning, he wouldn't accept the milk of anyone else except mama, except his mother's. SubhanAllah, Allah Azza wa Jalla programmed it in his little heart, don't accept anyone's milk. Because this is part of the divine plan. So what happened? Of course, Pharaoh now, he's even more angry. Actually, when isn't Pharaoh angry? He's always angry. You know, Pharaoh, when he wakes up, he's angry. When he goes to sleep, he's angry. When he's showering, he's angry. Even when he's happy, he's angry. That's Pharaoh for you. So he's angry, but now he's even more angry. Why? Because there's a crying baby in the castle. So he's had enough. He goes, go find this baby some milk. He sends them out. He sends out the women. And of course, his wife, Asiya, goes along with them. She didn't want to give up this kid. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَأَلْقَيْتُ عَلَيْكَ مَحَبَّةً مِنِّي. Allah said, we've made the love of you in the people's heart, ya Musa. People, when they see Musa alayhi salam, they just love him. So she loved him and the people loved him. And that's perhaps why Fir'aun ended up keeping him. So she didn't want to give him up. So she is sent out with, of course, some of the women and perhaps even a bodyguard. They went out to the marketplace in searching for pregnant, breastfeeding women. And who happens to be looking for Musa? At the time, of course, his sister. Her mom said, go and find what happened to him. So she's in the marketplace and she sees her baby brother in the hands of Asiya, you know, the queen. She's freaking out, what's going on? So she gets closer and she's looking at her brother, checking out the situation, but she's acting like she's not interested. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned, فَبَصُرَتْ بِهِ عَنْ جُنُوبٍ. She would look at him, but make it out like she wasn't really interested. SubhanAllah, what a smart girl, the sister of Musa alayhi salam. وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. The people had no idea. So they're asking, look, you know, can you try breastfeeding this kid? A woman would come, breastfeed, he wouldn't accept. So she realized what was going on. Ah, they're looking for a person that can breastfeed my baby brother. So she goes over to them. فَقَالَتْ هَلَّا دُلُّكُمْ عَلَى أَهْلِ بَيْتِ. She says, huh, can I guide you to a house? يَكْفُلُونَهُ لَكُمْ. They'll take good care of him. وَهُمْ لَهُ نَاصِحُونَ. These are good people. They're good folks. They've got a great reputation. They'll look after this kid for you. So she went up to them and she said that. Which house was she referring to? Her house. But she didn't say, Ahli, my house. She said, let me guide you to a house. What a smart girl. Allahu Akbar. She was at an age where she could distinguish between right and wrong. Perhaps 7, 8, 9, maybe 10 years of age. That is it. How many of us would have thought what to do in such a situation? Smart girl. Allahu Akbar. So the soldier grabbed her. He goes, why would this family look after this kid? How do you know? What makes you so sure? Do you know this child? He goes, no. They look after him because, of course, they want to look after the kingdom of Pharaoh. They go, very well. Show us where this house is. So she guided them back to her own house, but they had no idea it was her own house. Said, you know, you go down Auburn Road, you know, you get to the light, you take a right to Hume Highway, there's the house you want. So she's there with them. They get to the house. They knock on the door. The mother of Musa opens up. She sees a guard, she sees the queen, she sees these women. She's freaking out, what's going on? She sees her daughter. And then she looks and she sees her own child in the hands of Asiya. You can imagine how she's feeling now. An emotional roller coaster in her heart and mind. She's joyful, elated, happy, but she's confused, she's shocked, what's going on? She couldn't express her emotions. She had to hold herself back. You can imagine, because she's my baby and she grabbed her. They said, ah, this kid's yours. Murder him on the spot. She didn't know what to do. What's going on? You know, her daughter is there looking, you know, trying to give her signals, but she couldn't do anything. The guard's right there. So they say, breastfeed this kid. What do you mean breastfeed him? Is this a trap she's thinking? Is this a trick? Maybe if I breastfeed him and he takes from me, they're going to realize I'm the mom. He's dead for sure. Breastfeed him, breastfeed him. She was reluctant, you can imagine. She takes the child, puts the child to her breast. Musa alayhi salam begins to breastfeed. And they say, we found our woman. I'm caught out, I'm busted, what's going on? What do you mean you found your woman? We found our woman. Lady, we're going to offer you a job to breastfeed this kid. Allahu Akbar. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, فَرَدَدَنَاهُ إِلَىٰ أُمِّهِ. We reunited Musa with his mum. كَيْ تَقَرَّ عَيْنُهَا وَلَا تَحْزَنْ. So she may not be grieved. She may not be upset. وَلِتَعْلَمَ أَنَّ وَعْدَ اللَّهِ حَقٍ. And finally, so she may know the promise of Allah is true. How many of us sometimes doubt what's happening to the ummah? What's happening here? Why did this have to happen? Allah said, the promise of Allah is true. She was reunited with her child. Not just that, you know, Allah could have reunited them. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the child is safe, true? You know, he could have went in the river, went around the block and came back. That was a nice ride, Habibi. So just because he was reunited, that doesn't mean he's safe. But Allah didn't just reunite mother and child. He reunited them in such a way where he's going to be raised in the castle of Pharaoh. If there's any place you want to be safe from Pharaoh, it's with Pharaoh. So he's safe. On top of that, he's raised as a prince, eating like a prince, dressing like a prince. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ba'd. One more final lesson that we can draw from this amazing story of Prophet Musa alayhi salam and his mother is that when Allah commanded her to put the child in the river, you can imagine she was terrified. So Allah commanded her to do so, and then Allah Azza wa Jal comforted her by saying, وَلَا تَخَافِ وَلَا تَحْزَنِي. Don't fear, don't grieve. Now, if you want to instruct someone, you want to give someone a command, but they're terrified, they're scared, what do you do logically? You calm them down first, true? There's no point instructing someone, teaching someone, when they're scared, nothing's going to enter. So let's just imagine there's a fire, you know, and the brother's scared out of his mind. You want to show him the exits that way. You say, Akhi, calm down, relax, don't be afraid. There's the exit. True, in that order. You calm them down, then instruct. But Allah didn't say that in that order. Allah Azza wa Jal switched it. Allah said, فَأَلْقِهِ فِي الْيَمْ. Throw him in the river, put him in the river. وَلَا تَخَافِ. Don't be afraid. Allah switched it. The command came first, then don't be afraid. You know what that teaches us? That sometimes we're afraid to do something. We're afraid to fulfill an Islamic command. Leaving riba, leaving a job that is forbidden, leaving the haram relationship, dressing more modestly, praying at work, whatever the case may be. فَبِاللَّهِ كَمْ تَسْتَطِبُّ الْقُرُوحُ وَيَبْرَأُ جُرُوحُ الْكَسِيرِ الْجَرِيحِ وَيَنْشَطُ ذَاكَ السَّقِيمُ الْعَلِيمُ وَقَدْ كَانَ بِالسُّقْمِ دَهْرٌ.